This is the Laowa 9mm f2.8 ultra wide angle lens. Now, I've been using this for about a month, and this is a very unscientific and technical review of this lens and how I found using it. Now, it's a crop sensor lens. It's available for the Sony E mount, for the Canon EF mount, and for the Fuji X mount, which is what this is. And the first thing to say about this is that it's not a replacement for this, which is my 10-24. It's my go-to zoom for landscapes. But what this doesn't have, and this does have, this is an f4 lens, this is f2.8. And it's that attracted me to this lens in the first place. The 10-24 isn't a particularly good lens for shooting stars. The fact that it's f4 means that you have to use a longer shutter speed, which can blur the stars, or open the ISO, increase the ISO a little bit, which can deteriorate the image. This, the fact that it's f2.8, that little bit faster, makes it a much better lens for shooting stars. Now, in the past, I've been using the 14mm, which is a great lens. It's super sharp, but it's not quite wide enough. When you're shooting stars, quite often you want to have maybe something in the foreground and as much sky as possible to fit as much of the Milky Way or as much of the Northern Lights as possible. The 14mm is a little bit limited, but this has a much wider field of view. And just to give you an idea of what the difference is, this is, I'm shooting this at 18mm, this is 14mm, and this is 9mm. So you can see how huge and how wide the field of view is and how much you can fit in the image. Now, last year, Fuji had on their roadmap the 8-16mm f2.8 zoom, which was announced last month, and that looks like a great lens. Now, I haven't had the opportunity to use that yet. Hopefully I'll get my hands on one later this year and I'll be giving it a thorough test. And while that lens will almost certainly have a fantastic field of view and the fact that it's f2.8 will make it a great star lens, it's a really big lens at 800 and something grams. This is 215 grams and it's tiny, as you can see. And the other thing about the 8-16 is that it looks like it doesn't take filters. This has a 49mm filter thread on the front, which means you just need a step-up ring and you can use it with a regular filter system. So that's a really big advantage and make it just a great lens for me to be able to drop in the bag just for the times when I think I might be able to shoot stars. All right, so what about the build quality? Now, it's almost completely metal. There's a little bit of plastic on the focus ring and a little bit of plastic on the aperture ring, but it's really well made. As I say, I've been using it for a month. I've used it next to some water walls in some quite nasty conditions in Iceland, and it handled everything really well. I generally don't tend to worry about whether a lens is weather sealed or not. This isn't classed as being weather sealed, but none of the lenses that I use are. The 10-24 isn't, the 55-200, which I use a lot in landscape shooting, isn't. So weather sealing for me, it's not a game changer. It's not a deal breaker. And as I said, this has handled everything that that I've thrown at it quite well. The other thing to know about this lens is that it is manual focus only. It will not work with the autofocus on your camera. You can see here it has no connectors, so there's nothing in this lens to communicate with the autofocus in your camera, so you have to use it in manual focus. Now, that shouldn't be a problem. If you put this in f8 to f11, you've got a really long depth of field. Now, you can see here, just as an example, I was shooting with the lens, and this is with the focus peaking on the Fuji camera, which makes shooting in manual incredibly easy. Now, everything that you can see here, from the lamp just in front of the lens, it's about 60 centimeters in front of the lens, all the way up the street to infinity, everything is in focus. So the fact that this is a manual focus only lens shouldn't put you off. It's incredibly easy to use and you'll get an incredibly wide depth of field while using it. The first time you attach it, because it doesn't have any of those adapters, any of those connectors, you'll find that the camera won't communicate with it. So you have to go into the menu of the camera, you go to the user settings, you go to button dial settings, and then just switch on shoot without lens. And as soon as you've done that, then you can use this lens just fine. And all your other lenses will still work fine. And it's something that you only have to do once. All right, so what about the optics of this lens? What about the image quality? How sharp is it? What kind of shots can you expect to take with this lens? Now, as I said, this is not a technical review, but what I can do is have a look at some of the test shots that I've done over the last month. This is one of the train stations in Lisbon, and it's got this really big canopy that you need an extremely wide lens to shoot. Even with the 10 millimeter, it kind of struggles to fit it all in, but with the 9 millimeter, you really get the entire sweep. So that focal length really does benefit in this kind of architecture shot. And you can see, just zooming in, if we go down into the borders here in the bottom corner and in the bottom right corner, it's plenty sharp there, looking all the way through the lens, through the centers. It's quite sharp, lots of definition. The colors are really contrasty, and it's done a very good job. Again, this is the same place. It's been converted into black and white, but again, just zooming in, if you look at the detail here, the reflection in the windows, the writing on the windows, the detailing on this screw, and again, we're into the borders of the lens here, and you can see it's done a really nice job. There's always going to be an element of distortion when you're shooting architecture because of keystoning and things like that. But you can see here that generally it's not done a bad job right across the frame. We've got the verticals straight here on the right side of the frame. They're not too bad. On the left side of the frame, there's a little bit of an angle there, but that's also to do with the height and the angle that I was holding the camera at. I didn't have it at exactly 90 degrees to the floor. So things like this are pretty much inevitable when you're using a wide angle lens. But I think that the 9mm does a very good job of keeping the distortion down. Here's another image. Again, this is just to show how sharp and contrasted it is. This is, again, it's using manual focus because you have to with the lens. This is a moving object, but it gives you can see here this funicular is moving down, but the camera's focused really well. There's a lot of depth of field, so we've got all the way up to the back there. Really contrasty, really sharp, lots of detail. Looking at over here into the corner where the washing's out on the line and the graffiti on the wall, you can see plenty of detail all the way up into the corner. This is a landscape. Now, again, this isn't a particularly good shot for demonstrating detail, but what this does sh start show is how you start to get vignetting with this lens. You can see in the top left here and the top right, it certainly is darker. And right in the top left, I did sort of notice it gets qu you get this, you do get quite a bit of vignette in there. Now, this is certainly possible to remove in post-processing. It's not too much of a problem. And when you have such a wide field of view, and particularly this is taken at the sunrise, you can see here the sun is just coming up. There is always going to be an element of light fall off. Now, I wasn't using any filters on this shot. It is much darker at the bottom. It is typical in wide angle lens to get this some kind of light fall off when you have a low light like this, when you're shooting in sunrise and sunset. But it is one of the things that I noticed with this lens. It does vignette much more than the 10-24. This was shot in Iceland. Now, this has filters, and the vignetting has been exacerbated by the use of the filters. You can see, particularly over here on the left, you can see the light fall off from here and here, much more to the borders of the frame where it gets very dark, and down into the corners here. Now, there's a 9-stop neutral density filter on here, and also I was using a graduated neutral density filter to keep this bright part of the sky down. That's going to significantly increase the amount of vignetting you can see here in this corner. But this is something that I can solve. It's not a particular problem. It's something that can be dealt with. It's time consuming. It's something that I have to do. I would prefer it if it wasn't vignetting, but it's not particularly bad. And you can see here that the detail on the lens, now again, all of these are shot in manual focus. The detail is incredibly good. It's pulling out a lot of detail, even down into the borders here. Now, this is another shot that is in Iceland, and it gives you a good idea of the advantages of using a lens this wide, because on previous occasions I'd been unable to do this in one shot. I had to do it as a panorama, and even then using a wide angle lens and two or three shots to be able to get the entire sweep of the waterfall, the way that the river goes all the way down the valley, to have an element of foreground in and still be able to fit sky in the top. Now, to be able to do that with one lens, because the 10 millimeter doesn't really give you quite as much, but this 9mm focal length really did manage to get the entire sweep in, and it makes for quite a dramatic shot. And again, this is a raw straight out of the camera. You can see there's a little bit of softening around this stone here, right in the corner. It's not pin sharp, but overall, I haven't treated this image, I haven't sharpened it, it's a raw file. That really isn't bad at all. You can see here in the other corner, again, when we look at this plant and this detailing at 100%, it really is quite sharp all the way through to this detail of the rock at the back. It really produces lovely sharp images. This is an image taken at the end of my street. Just really wanted to show you that it does, what kind of sun stars it produces. This is it with the aperture set to f22, which is really the best aperture for getting sun stars. Just handheld shooting right into the sun, just to show what kind of sun star you get there. And the fact that there's not really any flare or anything else across the rest of the lens, it's done a very good job of keeping the flare down. There is vignetting in the right corner, but like on all the images that I've shown you, the detail is really quite lovely. And this is the last shot, and it's just really an attempt, a not very good attempt, to show the level of distortion or the lack of distortion when shooting this lens. I stood opposite this doorway, tried to compose it as straight as possible so you could see from these horizontal and verticals here. If you look all the way down the left side of the frame here, there's a complete lack of distortion. All the way along the top, it's very straight. Now, it's not perfect there, but that's more to do with my positioning, the way that I was standing, looking at the image, looking at the scene, than with any distortion in the camera, in the lens. The lens really does an excellent job of dealing with distortion. So overall then, I've been extremely impressed with the lens. It's really sharp, it handles distortion incredibly well, and even though it vignettes quite a bit, it's not particular problem. It's something that I've been able to deal with quite easily in Photoshop. The build quality is very good, and even though it's manual focus only, that's not something that's been a problem for me. I found it incredibly easy to use, and I've been really satisfied with the image quality that I've been getting from it. Now, at $499, I think it represents extremely good value for money, and this is certainly a lens that I'll be keeping with me and dropping it in my bag on any trip where I expect to be shooting the stars. And in that respect, it's definitely replaced the 14mm in my camera bag. It hasn't replaced the 10-24, but I do think that this no longer means that I'm quite so interested in the 8-16mm lens, and I'm not quite sure that I'll be picking that lens up at the moment. Now, I hope this has been useful. I hope it's been interesting. If there's anything that I've missed, or if there's anything that you'd like to know, just please ask me and drop a comment in the box below, and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. So once again, thanks for watching, and as ever, take care.